Hi there, my name is Sabrina Smai from Microsoft's AI framework team. And I want you to imagine you're a performance engineer at a company, and your job is to help identify potential bottlenecks and potential scalability issues in your company's deep learning system that's already in place. Typically, this is how you'll start. You'll begin by running the deep learning model and capture traces along the way. But in order for you to optimize your model, you would need to gather profiling results and manually analyze them. But the problem is that traces can be gigabytes and gigabytes of data, and processing them manually can be a very time-consuming and annoying task. So once you've identified the changes you need to make to slightly optimize your model, you would need to run your model again, check the performance, and if the performance is great, then hooray, awesome, go get yourself a celebratory beer because you're done for the day. Otherwise, you'll need to go back to step one, recapture a profile, gather the results, find out the reason for the bottleneck, and fix it, try it over again. You might have to try this process an N number of times until the performance is satisfactory. You can imagine how incredibly exhausting that is. But here at Microsoft, we partnered with Facebook to bring performance engineers, data scientists, framework engineers, or anyone looking to optimize their PyTorch model, bring them a tool to allow you to collect performance metrics during training and inferencing, and be provided actionable guidance on how to optimize your PyTorch model performance. And that tool is called PyTorch Profiler. In this session, I will go over the new PyTorch Profiler release and how you can get started leveraging this performance tool today. To end before a very short demo, I'll actually be speaking about our upcoming features that are really exciting, so stay tuned for that. Here are a few features we added in a version 1.9. We added distributed training view, memory view for tracking your memory usage. We added GPU utilization view for you to maximize your hardware. TensorBoard now has cloud storage support. And the last feature that we added that's super cool is that on Visual Studio Code, you can actually click on a trace file and it will take you directly into the source code where the bug is. That makes it easier for debugging. In version 1.10 of PyTorch Profiler, we released a few enhancements and a few new features. The first one being an enhanced memory view. This helps you understand your memory usage better. And we also added a few additional statistics like understanding your memory usage trend, which is quite useful. The second is an enhanced automated system. So we actually enhanced the feature that provides you performance recommendations to help you optimize your model. So whether you're lost on how to get started, you know, optimizing your model, or need a few quick actionable hints on how to optimize it, that's the tool to use, which is really helpful. The third is around distributed training. Along with its ability to help you diagnose distributed training on individual nodes, Glue is officially now supported. The fourth feature is around correlating your operators in forward and backward pass. This helps you sort of map the operations that are found in the forward pass to the backward pass and vice versa. And these can all be visualized on a trace view. The fifth feature is around Tensor Core. We officially now support Tensor Core. Now, onto the demo. The first feature I'll be showing is Memory View. Memory View is a feature that allows you to understand the time and memory consumption that may have caused potential bottlenecks in your code, whether it is out of memory errors or memory fragmentation issues. This memory view allows you to see which operator by the name, exactly by the name, is contributing to the high consumption of time and memory. And in this release, you can now see the trend of your memory usage by showing you the memory events within the specified range that you've specified here. The next feature to show is distributed training view. So diagnosing distributed training view jobs can be very difficult without a distributed training view like this. And you can observe stragglers or workers not having enough work, etc., from these charts. And in addition, in this particular release, we support Glue. Now, the next feature I'll be showing is GPU utilization. Imagine you have a ResNet 50 model with a batch size of 4. And you can see that many of the workers are running, and you can see the device type. You can also see some of the GPU summary. So, you know, the GPU utilization, SM efficiency, and some of the accuracy information, which are three very important metrics when it comes to GPU. But you can see that this is quite low. And if GPU utilization is low, this could potentially suggest that there is a bottleneck in your model. So there's clearly a bottleneck since your goal is to get 100% utilization. 100% utilization means that you're leaving no performance on the table and you're fully using your hardware to its full extent. Now down here, it suggests that perhaps increasing your batch size and adding tensor core will actually help you with this bottleneck. So the next run that we see here, you'll see that we have increased our batch size and added tensor core as per the recommended section at the bottom here. And you can now see that GPU utilization jumped a significant amount from the last run, just by taking these actionable steps. But there's still room to improve. So to further diagnose, we can actually move to the trace view. So this is where you get detailed information on some of the elements in the trace, the states that they're in, some of the events in 10 millisecond buckets, both on the GPU and CPU side, as you can see over here. Over here, we actually recorded a number of profiler steps that correspond to the training iteration in this particular case. And what you can do is you can actually add a record function to your program. And what that does is that it makes trace a lot easier to understand. So when we're looking at the trace, you can see that there's profiler steps. And if you zoom in, you can see that the operator's under the profiler steps, but it's actually hard to map it to your code. So this is exactly where the record function occurs. So the first thing that we typically do when we're on this trace is that we view the GPU utilization in the timeline. So in a trace view, you can easily observe specific areas of your program where the GPU utilization is low. And if it's high, you know, awesome, that means that there's not much room to improve, that you're using your, you know, hardware to its full extent, not, you know, you're not leaving any performance on the table. But if it's low, then that means that that's an opportunity to increase it. So that's what we're going to be doing here today. So we can actually observe unusual spikes or dips by zooming in and out. You know, we can first observe this region over here that has an unusual dip. Here, it seems like there's zero utilization, and then over here, it's 66.6 utilization. But like, what exactly is happening here? To get finer detail, we can actually go to the SM efficiency. So this, the SM efficiency, you can see that there's some sparsity micro gaps that are present here, and that could possibly be due to your PyTorch code looping over some vector or data structure, or you should be doing those things on a GPU instead. So over here, we added a function tracing. So you can actually zoom in and you can see that there's data loaders that are doing a bunch of iterations at the beginning of the epoch on the input data here. So that's what's causing the GPU to idle. In step 17, 18, 19, those all look good, right? It seems like GPU utilization and all those metrics are pretty decent. But in the cases where GPU utilization is high and SM efficiency is low, that could possibly mean that some of the SMs, some of their workload is actually pretty low. So they're not getting much work for them to be efficient and high. So what we can do next is go to stream 7. And stream 7 is where all the GPU activity happens. So you can see that it's very sparse in step 18, which is bad GPU utilization. So if you click on one of these, we can click on one of them in the stream and you can see, look, the data size that it's being worked on and some of the achieved occupancy is so low. And that's what's causing the low GPU utilization. But you're probably wondering, like, why does that happen? So there's a new feature that we released, and we can actually enable this async feature to map back to the CPU to see exactly what Python function are being used and what exact PyTorch operator are being used. So now you can use this Python function, a little sneak peek of a future release, and figure out exactly how to improve it, whether you can do it on a CPU or a fused kernel or some other technique that can help increase that utilization. So the last thing I'd like to show is that we can do forward and backward pass correlation by turning on this feature over here. So A lot of problems are happening on step 18, as you can see. And they're all in the forward pass. But if you were to correlate that, you can see that those are all replicated in the backward pass as well. So there's a lot of useful features in this demo that can really help optimize your PyTorch models. All right, so now this is the really exciting part. Here's a few sneak peek on some of the exciting upcoming features that we have planned. Okay, the first one is PyTorch function tracing. Okay, this is a feature that allows you to understand what's happening on the CPU side. Oftentimes, traces don't really give you a lot of information on why is the CPU idling. You know, it seems like nothing's going on. But as long as you're using Python, you'll be able to get all the function calls that you've used to be able to understand what is happening to your CPU being idle. The second feature that we're going to be releasing is a model attribution feature, okay? So traces give you very low-level PyTorch, you know, operators, but why can't we at least see some of the module names associated with them? So with this tool, you will be able to allow yourself to map some of the time consumption into modules in Python, in a Python script. The last feature that I'd like to highlight is graph visualization. This is a super exciting feature that helps you visualize the Python model in a graph, which is really helpful for trying to debug and really optimize your models. Now, here's a few sneak peeks of a list of things that are coming down in our pipelines down the road. So, you know, look out for these because these are really exciting and will really help make your workflow a lot more efficient. We put together a few references on tutorials and release blogs and a few talks that we've given, so please feel free to check it out, and let's get profiling.